Ladies and gentlemen, hello and good morning. Today is an historic day here in Düsseldorf. In just a few hours' time, and for the first time ever, the G20 ministers responsible for the digital economy will begin meeting under the G20 presidency. The stakes are high, and all of you here today, you have a role to play. More on that in just a moment. But first, welcome to the G20 Multi Stakeholder Conference, Digitalization, Policies for a Digital Future. My name is Sarah Kelly. I host the main international news program on Deutsche Welle TV in Berlin. We're Germany's international broadcaster, and today I'm really thrilled that I get to be here in Düsseldorf in order to be your moderator. We have a fantastic program coming up for you today. We're going to be having a look at one of the key priorities for the G20 under the German presidency, that is, of course, digitalization. And we know that many of you out there, you are working on the front lines of digitalization, making decisions at the highest of levels. So we thank you very much for being here today. I mentioned earlier that all of you have a role to play, that we're relying on your input. That's because the hope today is that we might be able to tap into a little bit of your expertise and your insight in order to influence policies coming out of the G20. Policies which hopefully provide for a more sustainable future. So, we challenge all of you to get involved today, especially in the three simultaneous panel sessions that we have coming up in a little over an hour's time, and also the minister's talk coming up later this afternoon. Our host today is the German Ministry for Economic Affairs and Energy. A lot of people, a lot of work went into making this conference possible, so thank you very much to them for providing the platform. A couple of quick notes before we get started. For those who are interested, we have simultaneous translation in both English and German. So if you do need that, please feel free to find one of our organizers and pick up one of those headsets. We're also using the hashtag for those of you who are on Twitter, and hopefully that should be all of you. This is a digital conference after all. We're using the hashtag G20Digital. So our intention with that is that anytime you have a question, a comment, or even if you want to just take a selfie, just please post that. We're going to be going through the feed from time to time, and we're going to integrate those questions into our panel sessions and also into the minister's talk. So do feel free to use that. Again, the hashtag is G20Digital. Now, with that, I'm going to hand it over now to a whole host of people who would like to welcome you here today. We are very fortunate to be joined, for example, by the mayor of Düsseldorf, Thomas Geisel. We also have Franz-Josef Lersch-Mense. His official title is the Minister of Federal Affairs, Europe and the Media for the state of North Rhine-Westphalia, which is the state that we are currently in. And of course, last but certainly not least, the German Minister for Economic Affairs and Energy, our host today, Brigitte Zypries. We will begin now with the mayor of Düsseldorf. So please join me in giving a very warm welcome to Thomas Geisel. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, Sarah. Sehr geehrte Frau Ministerin, liebe Brigitte.
Minister Zypries, Minister Franz-Josef Lersch-Mense, ladies and gentlemen. I would like to start by bidding you a very warm welcome to the state capital of Düsseldorf. And for the people of Düsseldorf, it is a pleasure and also an honor to host this multi-stakeholder conference. Later on, of course, we will also be hosting the summit of the G20 ministers meeting. And of course, you chose your destination well, because Düsseldorf is quite the right place to host this meeting. It is the state capital of Germany's largest state of North Rhine-Westphalia. It is a city located at the heart of Europe and at the heart of Germany's largest economic center, the area of the Rhine and Ruhr area, which has a very large number of people, and also about 15,000 companies. It's a highly prosperous city. It is also one of the fastest growing ones in Germany. And Düsseldorf is very much known for its very diverse economic structure and industry. We have traditional local manufacturing jobs, for instance, with Daimler. The Sprinter model is produced here. Then we have Henkel here. And they've been here for 140 years. Their headquarters is in Düsseldorf. Also, Düsseldorf is Germany's second largest banking and financial center. And as you may well know, it is also Germany's fashion capital, Germany's advertising and marketing capital. And it is also known for providing high-quality services. And Düsseldorf is very well prepared for the challenges of the digital transformation. Over the past 25 years, Düsseldorf has created a high-performing cluster of IT companies. And all of the largest manufacturers in this sector have an office in Düsseldorf. Many Asian companies have their European centers here in Düsseldorf. And for 2 years now, Düsseldorf has also been becoming somewhat of a start-up hub, in particular for innovative digital startups. So as you can see, we are creating the infrastructure for this. And tonight, if you come to the port of Düsseldorf for tonight's reception, you will also see that this port is also becoming a center of innovation. And I hope the construction sites won't be too much of a disturbance. This city really is on the move, and we are becoming a startup hub, and we are very proud of it. We're also proud of the fact that the Federal Ministry for Transport has chosen Düsseldorf as a site for a testbed for autonomous driving. And the state of North Rhine-Westphalia has also chosen Düsseldorf as its digital hub, or one of its digital hubs. And the Düsseldorf DigiHub, Düsseldorf Rhineland GmbH, is a company that has been tasked with creating new digital business models and supporting companies that do so. This is happening at the port of Düsseldorf, but also elsewhere. There are many co-working sites mushrooming in this city, particularly in former industrial sites. So be inspired by the city of Düsseldorf and by its spirit. Be inspired by the city that is very much prepared for the digital age. And don't forget, when you're having all these interesting locations, that it's also a great city simply to enjoy. So take a walk along the River Rhine. And I can only recommend that you also visit a brewery and drink a traditional Altbier from Düsseldorf. And of course, if you can't find the time today, then you are kindly invited to come back in June. We'll have a section of the Tour de France here in Düsseldorf. Welcome. Minister Zypries, members of the G20 delegations, members of the host countries and of the guest countries, representatives of international organizations, Ms. Nemeth, Dr. Wang. It's a pleasure for me to welcome you on behalf of the state government of North Rhine-Westphalia. Our minister president, Hannelore Kraft, sends her regards. So does Minister Gerd Dünweide. Unfortunately, both of them have to be at the state parliament today and can't attend this meeting, but they wish you every success for this meeting. North Rhine-Westphalia, NRW, is the state with the largest economy in Germany. Our GDP is similar to that of Turkey, which puts it 18th in the world. That's, of course, assuming that North Rhine-Westphalia were a state of its own. But Ms. Zypries, don't worry, North Rhine-Westphalia has no plans of secession. We don't want to create our own country. 23% of all foreign direct investment that is incoming to Germany goes to North Rhine-Westphalia, and there are 18,000 foreign companies employing more than 855,000 people in this state, and the numbers are growing. And we invite you to also make a contribution to this. Of course, North Rhine-Westphalia is not only a large German state, it's also a great policy city. It's a great place for us to think about new policies for a digital future. North Rhine-Westphalia has always been shaped by constant change. Ever since the 1960s, our state has been in a permanent state of structural change. For many decades, we were the state that used to power Germany with coal, and this, of course, had to do with the economic miracle, or made this possible. And then later on, we moved towards services, but without neglecting traditional second sector jobs. And of course, we're also working hard on the digital transformation. Nowadays, North Rhine-Westphalia is one of the leading IT hubs in Germany, and we have a very strong digital sector. There can be no doubt that digitization is the most pressing task in our times. This goes for e-commerce, for robotics that can be used in nursing, geriatric nursing. It can be used for 3G printing, accessing customers, geodata for agricultural purposes, many services. All of this is only possible if we have digitization. And this is why digitization has become a major priority for the G20 presidency in Germany. And it is, of course, also top of our agenda in North Rhine-Westphalia. We are convinced that we must not repeat past errors. We can't protect the past from the future. Minister President Hannelore Kraft said in her declaration on digital change is opening up new opportunities for North Rhine-Westphalia, not only when it comes to growth and jobs. It is also opening up new prospects for a better quality of life and for greater sustainability. Ladies and gentlemen, you may be wondering how such a global issue can be developed at local or regional level and how we can shape this. Well, in our economic policy, we are focusing on three areas. First of all, on shaping a framework for the digital economy. Secondly, we have a gigabit strategy for extending our broadband networks. And we also focus on data-driven production, the Internet of Things Industry 4.0. This is all part of our guiding principles for our policy, underpinning our policy. I would like to give you some examples from our state. So our goal for our strategy for digital change here in North Rhine-Westphalia is to create greater synergies between traditional business models, SMEs, and innovative digital startups. We want to harness this potential, and this is something that we did not think of in an ivory tower or in the back room of a ministry. No, this is actually the result and the outcome of stakeholder dialogue. Tobias Kollmann and Minister Dün from North Rhine-Westphalia are part of the Advisory Council of Digital Affairs, and they've been working with this body and is also with associations, companies, and networks. And many ideas have been put forward and debated. And at the end of the day, the result was the digital strategy, which points out six specific measures. And at the heart of this strategy are the six, that is the formation of the six digital hubs, one of them in Düsseldorf. And these are regional platforms for national and international startup entrepreneurs and also for cooperation between startups, industry, and also universities who can work together to create new digital business models. North Rhine-Westphalia is a large state, and this is why we have decided not to have just two sides or one side. No, instead, we are promoting networks all over the state. And by doing so, we are creating incentives for digital transformation. And we are also calling upon people to take responsibility for this. We are very much leading the way in Germany. We're the first German state to have its own digital hubs. And there are some others that are now imitating us, and we're delighted to see this. And Minister Zypries, we're delighted that the Federal Ministry for Economic Affairs and Energy is also supporting digital hubs, and that one of them will be located in Dortmund, which is also in North Rhine-Westphalia. Ladies and gentlemen, before I close, I would like to make two more points. First of all, we are not only focused on economic success. There are two other points that are very important that we need to consider if we want to be successful as we shape digital change. Education and further and continuing education is very important. Back in 2016, we created a guiding principle underpinning our education policy in the digital age. We want to make sure that we have media diversity and that everybody can participate in the digital society. This is extremely important to us. And as we cooperate internationally, we need to make sure that we have transparency, data privacy, and that we also create cybersecurity. We need to ensure that people can trust in digital media and that we build trust in these technologies. And it is my conviction that we will be able to succeed if we work together with industry and with society. Digitization is a challenge for all of society at all levels, at local, regional, and national, and of course, international level. In North Rhine-Westphalia, we have always fared well, particularly in our advisory council and in the gigabit action as we have worked together with others. We've also formed the Alliance for Work and Labor 4.0. We're working with companies, with associations, with trade unions, and with science and academia. And in this work, we have looked at the implications of digitization on the labor market. And this is why it was very wise to decide that the G20 Multi Stakeholder Conference should be hosted in preparation for the session of tomorrow. I wish you every success in your work. And of course, I also wish you every success in your analog meetings today. It's a pleasure for us to be welcoming you. Welcome to the digital state of North Rhine-Westphalia. And please do come back, not only to our websites, but also come back to our wonderful state. I would like to thank you, and I'd like to hand the floor over to Minister Zypries. Thank you.
Yeah.
Well, dear colleagues from the G20 countries, welcome to Düsseldorf. You just heard that in exactly the right place. Thank you very much for the kind words of welcome, Thomas Geisel and Josef Lersch-Mense. It's a great pleasure to be able to welcome you all here. And I'm sure that Düsseldorf will come up with some sunshine for us as well, so that we can enjoy our analog existence in this place with the right weather. But right now we're interconnected, and therefore we're in a dark room. Now, shaping an interconnected world is the subject we're going to be looking at today and tomorrow. here today at this conference of the stakeholders, and then this evening and tomorrow with the ministers of the G20 countries. This is the first time that digital ministers have convened, and this shows that digitalization really has advanced so far that we urgently need to focus on it specifically. And let me assure you, this is just the beginning of a debate. We have a lot of opportunities ahead of us, but we also have a lot of challenges. These challenges are societal. What's going to happen in societies? They're economic. What does it mean for our world of work in future? And of course, there's also an employment policy aspect. What will happen to jobs, particularly here in North Rhine-Westphalia? These debates are very familiar. And we're just at the outset of this process, not at the end of it. And we're trying to manage a digital transformation, not a digital disruption. The dynamism of this process, ladies and gentlemen, is, of course, enormous. And for policymakers, it's quite a difficult task. You've always got to strike a balance between leaving scope for technological developments, but also making sure that technologies don't have too negative impacts on society. And therefore, it's good that we are discussing this at G20 level, because this is a global issue and because we need this dialogue between countries so that we can get sufficient input and coordination about how we can work together on this. And therefore, we will be talking about, tomorrow we'll be talking about how we can try and get everybody in the world to benefit from digitalization. And this, I should also say, this is a very good forum for this, because the G20 really cover almost 2/3 of the world's population, almost 90% of global GDP, and 3/4 of global trade. So with the G20, and then there are other countries which Germany has invited as permanent guests, Spain, Netherlands, Norway, and Singapore. And I've also invited the representatives of Poland as well to attend. But also for other countries which are not directly part of the G20, we can say, for these countries, we can say that the decisions taken by the G20 send out a clear signal. And digitalization must not only happen in large industrial countries or in large metropolises, but rather we need to make sure that we don't divide the centres and the marginal areas, but we need to make sure that the rural areas have the same connectivity in all G20 countries. And of course, all areas of life are affected. Everybody should benefit. That's what something we call inclusive growth. This conference today is a forum for a dialogue between all the groups in civil society. And I'm very grateful to all of those who have traveled here today, or maybe you've come from Düsseldorf, to participate in this process. We've got industrial associations, employers associations, trade unions, a lot of different groups and initiatives from society. It's great to have you with us. Welcome. Ladies and gentlemen, we've got various formats like Business 20 or Labour 20, Women 20, Youth 20, Think 20 for the G20 formats. All of these have been brought together in this conference, and everybody wants to take part to try and get viable solutions for all countries, no matter how different the structures are in these various countries. We, therefore, want to listen to what you have to say. We want to hear your messages. We want to hear what you have to tell to the politicians, the political leaders of the G20 countries, so that your ideas can feed into the legislative processes. Ladies and gentlemen, in order to build a better foundation, we started back in January by commissioning the OECD with the writing of a report on key areas of action for digitalization in the G20 countries. And let me just pick up a few of these issues. We're going to take note of the report and discuss it at various points today and tomorrow. But the first key point in the OECD report is, how can we ensure that digital technologies can meet with public acceptance equally in all areas, despite the different structures and different peoples in the different in the various countries? Because we need this equal spread if we're going to have inclusive growth. I think it's important for all the G20 countries to set national strategies in motion to promote inclusive growth. Inclusive growth means that everybody should benefit. So the world of work has to be restructured, education has to be restructured, so that everybody can benefit. And we want to discuss this experience, we want to discuss our solutions, and we therefore think it's very important that all the stakeholders should be around the same table. We're all in one room here, but in Germany we make sure that we focus on getting all the stakeholders around one table on a specific issue. So everything we've done during this parliament, we've always got the employers, the employees, academia and policymakers together around a table to talk about what we're doing. The fact that we've got the trade unions back on board again is a new thing under this government. It's very good, and I think it really has benefited us in many policy fields. And therefore, I can only encourage other countries to imitate this approach to policymaking. The second key point of the OECD report is the question of the infrastructure we need. How can we manage to expand the infrastructure in the way we need it? Of course, we need high-performance networks in order for the internet to be able to grow. And we are not top of the form in Germany, I have to say. And we know that we need to build up our gigabit networks up by 2025, because otherwise we won't be able to cope with the massive data flows which are coming our way. And therefore, we want to agree in the G20 group that up to 2025, everybody should have access to the internet. And that means that we need an awful lot of investment, ladies and gentlemen, both public and private sector. In Germany alone, we're talking about infrastructure investments of about 100 million euros so that we can have these gigabit networks in place by 2025. And we need incentives for that to happen, of course. And these can both, these might be incentives to promote investment, but it must also be regulatory approaches so that providers have to take certain measures. We in the Economic Affairs Ministries presented a white paper on digital platforms a few weeks ago. And we're looking at the platform economy and the need for regulation, but also looking at the expansion of the networks. We've brought the white paper with us, and you can see what specific ideas we have in that regard. The third question, ladies and gentlemen, raised by the OECD report is, what competition rules do we need? How can we foster innovation and investment whilst ensuring fair competition? At the moment, there's sort of fuzzy contours between online business and offline business. We have a new dynamism in our competition. And also, we're not only trading in physical products, but also data have become a commodity. And therefore, we need rules for a level playing field for analog and digital and hybrid business models. We want to try and agree on uniform or at least interoperable standards and cooperation formats. And the fourth complex is the question of how can we manage to get the SMEs on board and help them to tap the digital potential? We need to strengthen the digital skills of SMEs, of small and medium-sized enterprises. And that's a really key policy field for my ministry in this parliament. Mittelstand Digital is the motto for a lot of our funding programs, and probably the most impressive program is the fact that we've set up 10 centers of excellence, centers of competence for SMEs and the skilled craft sector, and that we're going to set up another 10 in the course of this year. And these are centers where SMEs can go and see how the Internet of Things works and ask their own questions about their own specific company and see how they can work with what we call Industry 4.0, the Internet of Things. The fifth question is, how can we manage to ensure that the machinery understand each other, that they speak the same language? How can we create common, open standards, the standards we need to have interoperable systems architecture? After all, we need that if Industry 4.0 or the Internet of Things, you'll need to learn the word Industry 4.0, by the way, because we're going to keep on saying Industry 4.0, and the Internet of Things. And this is something where, of course, the governments need to regulate, because otherwise we're not going to have that interoperability. The sixth question refers to the skills that employees need, because the world of work is going to change, and we need to understand that the new methods of production have to keep the employees on board. People have to accept them. We need to work with the trade unions and the employees' representatives to make sure that the processes of training are such that nobody's left behind. What I was talking about, inclusive growth. And Germany's Labour Ministry, Andrea Nahles, has presented a white paper on work 4.0, and there you can find all sorts of measures which the federal government will be taking. Seventh question, how can we boost confidence and consumer protection online? We need trust, we need consumer protection if it's going to work. If there's no trust, people won't use, businesses won't use the new opportunities, and therefore we need to intensify our cooperation within the G20 countries, and we need to talk about risk-based technical standards, guidelines, and best practices. Also, consumer protection is an area where we need to work. And therefore, the G20 are going to implement the OECD guidelines on e-commerce. And this will at least offer the same level of consumer protection as compared with people who buy offline or mail order stuff. Also, we need to talk about data privacy, data protection, data security. Of course, the standards vary widely across the G20 countries, and I'm sure you all know that this is a very important and sensitive issue for Germany. Eighthly, we asked how we can overcome gender-specific differences in the digital world. This morning, I talked to a group of women from parliaments of the G20 countries, and there, the key issue was how can we ensure that the disadvantages that women face can be overcome in the world of the Internet? How can we ensure that we have a level playing field for women in the Internet? We've got a recent study, and it says that the gender gap has actually increased from 2013 to 2016 in just 3 years, from 11 to 13%. And if you work that out, that means 250 million fewer women are online than men are online. And this gap is something that the governments need to address. If they don't do it, it's going to increase by another 100 million over the next 3 years. We can't possibly want that. So we need to talk about how to address that. We need to talk about how we can motivate more people to start up their own companies. Women are better in school qualifications, better in university qualifications, but they're not so willing to set up their own company. And the startup rate amongst women is very low in Germany as elsewhere. And we need to talk about that. We need to see how we can take measures, for example, to try and ensure that they have access to capital, whether we need to take regulatory action. The ninth question was e-commerce, digital trade. Digitalization, of course, is transforming trade, and there's massive potential in it for growth and jobs. But we can also see that there are impediments to growing impediments to digital trade. It might be data traffic, it might be commercial confidentiality, or it might just simply be market access. I am firmly convinced that we need free trade in a digitally interconnected world. No matter whether it's analog or digital, protectionism will never bring any good results. And therefore, we've placed this issue on the G20 agenda, and we want to agree, first of all, what does e-commerce, digital trade actually mean? We need a common definition. But then we also need to answer the question of how we can help developing countries to reap the benefits of digital trade. And we must make sure that we act together as a G20 and advocate open markets. Fair world trade must be strengthened, and we must show that globalization can be shaped in a fair way, and that we want to shape it in a fair way so that everybody can participate and reap advantages from it. You can see, ladies and gentlemen, that we believe with the OECD, we agree with the OECD that it's worthwhile approaching these issues in international cooperation. We have the pleasure and the opportunity today to learn about more about this from high-level panelists, and also to have a general dialogue with everybody convened here in this room. And this will hopefully give us a lot of new input and examples. I certainly look forward to this dialogue with you today, and I look forward to an exciting discussion. I'm quite sure that this conference will provide an important input for the global shaping of the digital transformation.
Thank you very much to Minister. Well, if there's one thing that is absolutely essential for growth in the digital economy, it is reliable broadband infrastructure. That is something that our first keynote of the day certainly knows a thing or two about. She is a member of the board at Deutsche Telekom, Germany's leading telecom group. And her keynote today is entitled, I quite like this title, Digitalization, Be There or Be Square. So we are here, and we're going to welcome now Claudia Neymat. Thank you.
Thank you. A wonderful good morning. So it's actually great to be here. And I must say, we live in an interesting time of technological developments. Actually, a few days ago, I visited a nearby planetarium together with my two kids. And the name of the show was Extraterrestrial Life? Yeah? And it was pointing to a scientific sensation some of you might have noticed. Because last year, a group of international scientists, also many German ones among them, discovered an Earth-type planet in the so-called life zone of our neighboring planet, Proxima Centauri. We will never get there, yeah? But I thought, being a physicist, oh my God, that is cool. That is really cool, yeah? There's a planet our size circling around in a zone where life is possible on our neighboring star. So my daughter, I have to say, found that super cool, and I think afterwards she drove the teacher pretty crazy because they had to take history of planets in the so-called Sachkundeunterricht for weeks. Yeah? And at least one thing happened afterwards when I was talking to the kids and also to my girl. When I asked what is a fantastic idea to be when you grow up, I think the number of answers saying top model superstar went down. Yeah? She actually said, "Mom, I want to be the first woman on Mars." And then she paused and said, "Mom, the first human being." Yeah, so much about that. So what does that have to do now with digitization? Yeah, you could say, "Oh, Mrs. Nehmert, we're not going to talk about astrophysics today." Yes, clear. But I think there is one thing, a spirit in it, which has to do a lot with our scheme, and that is curiosity, passion. The drive to understand, the drive to discover, which I always believe in all we do, is the basis on which we as mankind, as human beings, succeed, and on which we will figure out what is actually good for us in the digitization. Now, coming to the digitization, the world is fast. And it was said before, the success of the past does not at all guarantee the success of the future. And actually, 88% of the Fortune 500 companies listed in the middle of the last century are no longer there today. Yeah? And the question is for me always, how much is digital transformation, which I hope for, versus some disruption, which might also happen, yeah? If you like it or not. And the speed is actually defined by software, by computers. And in 2025, computer with the computing power of a human brain will only cost 1,000 euro. By the way, I'm not suggesting that that computer can nearly do what a human brain could do because they are more specialized. Huh? Not yet in 2025, yeah? But therefore, the development is really tremendous. Now, nobody understands the future perfectly, of course not, but I find it important to see what are the ingredients. From my perspective, what makes the digitization so special is that it's not the development in one technology, but actually that we are at a point in time when exponential, super rapid growth in different technology areas comes together at one point in time. And let me now start with the first one, artificial intelligence and machine learning. Round about 10 years ago, a computer, artificial intelligence, could not distinguish a kid 5 years old standing at the side of a road with a red coat, like this, from a street pole. Ein Straßenhydrant. And you can imagine for autonomous driving, or maybe let's take the first step for assisted driving, this is not a fantastic precision to have. Yeah? Today, machine learning has made dramatic progress. And I mentioned that yesterday in the group of the ladies when we were sitting together. What I found pretty impressive, at Oxford University, they created a lip-reading artificial intelligence algorithm. And that lip-reading artificial intelligence algorithm is able to read from the lips of a human being 178 times faster when there is no tone than an empathetic human being. Yes, you could say, whoop. Fantastic pattern recognition, yeah? So when I look at it, I must even say that the developments in this field are close to being spooky. And now just imagine one thing, and several tech companies are currently experimenting with that. You take all these intelligent machines, and you can connect their brains. When we want to connect, we talk to each other. And then we develop certain things, but when you connect these robotic brains, you have immediately in the learning mechanism what all the others have actually done. So that's actually pretty amazing. Now, practically in Deutsche Telekom, we are currently using machine learning for more practical things, like other companies as well, for example, for predictive maintenance, to understand in which areas of the network we have to substitute things, yeah, to make sure that we reduce the number of network breakdowns, stuff like that. Coming to the next thing, which is actually around the networks, the so-called 5G networks. And that's something we and other industry participants are heavily working on. Now, what is a 5G network? It's actually a physical infrastructure with a lot of fiber and small cells on which you can have different physical infrastructures. One scenario is actually to have a network that has super short reaction times. Today, the networks have a reaction time of 50 milliseconds, roundabout. A super sportsman or woman has a peak reaction of roundabout 5 milliseconds. Yeah, table tennis, 5 milliseconds. Last year, and as a tech head of Deutsche Telekom, I have to say I'm pretty proud of that. Deutsche Telekom was the first company, together with our tech partners from the US and China and Europe, produced an end-to-end 5G system with a low latency speed record of 1 millisecond. But of course, it was only a pilot system in doing this. Now you could ask me, okay, yeah, what do we need that for? What do we need that for? So, and I will give just two practical examples. Number one, if you want to steer an industrial robot from remote, yeah, for example, if you would want to do a remote surgery, or another example would be you take a robot who is more like an invulnerable avatar of yourself, yeah, and have that invulnerable avatar of yourself go into a burning house, a burning forest, or help with the decontamination of an area. Yeah, and you need a machine who can do that actually very precisely. That's one area. Another, probably more immediate and practical area would be everything around augmented or virtual reality. And I'm not talking about Pokemon to go, which is kids find actually pretty cool, and it's actually, we had these queues here on the Königsallee all the time. Yeah, so this is gives you a hint. But imagine the next round, yeah? When you wear glasses, whether it's Google glasses, Zeiss glasses, or whoever glasses, and while you walk or do something, you get in real time relevant information that can be very practical for a technician who wants to fix things, but that could also be very playful. I recently tried it out playing a real Carrera race with my Carrera race, so, and getting information in real time about the speed of my competing races and about other things. So you could also do it in gaming. Now, if you do this today, you would have to carry a load of 20 kilo with you for the computing power to do this. And that's not very practical, because when you want to have a normal glass, it's not very practical to walk around with 20 kilo of load. But when you have 5G networks, the computing power for that could be at the edges in a so-called cloud, which is a data center at the networks. And that it works only if you have a connection which has a fantastic reaction time. Yeah, because otherwise, if it takes 100 milliseconds and you have the computing power somewhere, your experience makes you dizzy. It's actually not good. So this is actually about low latency. The other phenomenon about this is you can also have on the 5G networks the ability to manage a huge number of connected things. Last year, 3 billion human beings were connected in the world. 3 billion human beings. There are estimations that in the year 2020, round about 30 billion sensors will be connected, growing also exponentially from that field. So 30 billion sensors that need to be connected. And the sensors will be everywhere. We have them today in elevators to see when an elevator breaks down. We have them in all parts of the cars. We have them in our network. You might have them in a washing machine to indicate whether the water is pouring out. We have them on parking lots to sensor if there is a free space. And then you get the information on your app phone and you can travel there. You have them everywhere. And you might have even them in your body. For those in the healthcare sector, you might have noticed that last year was the first year when in the United States allowance was given to a so-called digital pill. Yeah, and how does that work? You actually swallow an indigestible mini sensor that measures the concentration of a certain substance in your stomach, gives that information to your app that sends it to the data center, and what do you get back? You get back personalized prescription, what is the specific, for your specific concentration of a substance you need to take. Yeah? So this hints into medicine for N equal to one, for one human being. Actually, my husband, who is a medical doctor, said to me, Claudia, this thing is against claustrophobia, so be careful with this example, because I don't know if claustrophobic patients really like to swallow this pill. Yeah, it's an inverse claustrophobia you are having. So, but anyhow, it says that the sensors will not stop in front of your body, so we will have them everywhere. And that means that we need to have networks which are able to cope safely with all the information from the different sensors. And it's a huge difference if you have to measure a few hundred thousand to handle routers in your network, or millions, billions of sensors. Yeah, it's a different network technology, it's a different capability, it's a different security requirement which we're having. And this thing called narrowband IoT is also part of a layer in 5G. So 5G can actually do quite a number of things. Yeah. Sensors, and then there's a question about security. Now, I could talk for an hour, but I will not do about security, but I think it's pretty clear anyhow and pretty obvious that the security challenges grow exponentially as the number of connections do. Yeah, and that we need to have dedicated new security concepts on that one. That's actually why we at Deutsche Telekom had decided 2 years ago to actually bundle all our security efforts in one area, work closely with research in Germany, in Israel, with Stanford University, work closely also with government bodies and hacker, the good hacker communities, to really understand what can be done. And recently we also announced a partnership towards Korea on quantum computing, yeah, and quantum cryptology. So this is one area where we put heavily research on as well to figure out what that means for security requirements. Now all these things come together and the question is, what do we do with them? Yeah. What I mentioned yesterday evening is, see, we have a challenge. The world we are living in is shaped by technologies few people understand. It's really a challenge. Because in the end, we need to jointly figure out what it is good for. And I agree with what Minister Zypries says. In the end, things are only good if it's good for everyone. Yeah. So the question is, what is actually good for everyone? What are the business models behind that? Yeah. What is going to happen? And even nowadays, for companies, the business models are different. A tech company like Geisel, for example, sold compression machines. And you need them when you go to a dentist and industrial applications everywhere. Now they are selling actually a compression service. You don't buy the machine, but the service to get compression air, and you get the maintenance. And a similar development is happening in Deutsche Telekom. I mean, our bulk of our business is selling connectivity. But when you think about this parking example, yeah, where we work together with cities and put sensors on the parking lots and bring that information on the apps of the citizens who live in that city so that they spare time not trying to find a parking lot. When we do this, the business model is not connectivity, but the business model is a fee for a parking service. So for our companies and in our industry and in the industrial sector, actually the business models change very much. What does that actually mean for all of us? I believe we need to change on all levels, and I do start because I have kids with the pupils. And I, please allow me to say a very tough word here. In Germany, it's actually a question of sheer luck. If you are a pupil, if you encounter a teacher who knows something about IT, at least in the first 6 to 7 years, it's pure luck. Or if you're lucky with your parents or your surroundings. Yeah? 2% of the teachers in Germany know something relevant about IT. I personally believe, really, that basic computational skills must be a must-have in schools. And by the way, I'm not talking about using a computer or being on a social network. And I'm also not talking about creating computational engineers and scientists in everyone. That's bullshit. Yeah? I'm basically talking about a basic understanding of coding and logic, a basic understanding about what can be done with data, a basic understanding about network, a basic understanding about the impact of social media and prejudice bias. Yeah, I think this is important for young kids to really understand that your self-esteem should not depend on the number of likes. Yeah, so therefore I believe we need to find a way to go faster on that one to make digital capabilities mandatory in every school. Now the question is how to get there fast with all these debates. I would actually generally propose that every teacher who leaves any university must have that as a compulsory subject. Needs to be part of the basic teacher education. And as that might take too long for today's generation, we might want to figure out some more practical avenues to rolling out tools, to have teachers who know something being connected, and to find new formats. Actually, I have to say now the gentleman from Düsseldorf is gone. I volunteer to take care of that in Düsseldorf, really. So, to practically take this. for personal passion and professional background to really show, I think we need to be faster and we cannot wait until the debates between the Kultusministerkonferenzen, I don't know what that is in English, yeah, is over. And sorry for our international guests here for this very specific German remark, but I have a real, real passion about this. We need to solve that pretty quickly. And you can count here, please, the political leaders on my help. I have really a personal passion to figure out how we do this. Then as a business, we have piloted at Deutsche Telekom with hundreds of people, a new approach where people could assess their own capabilities. And then we said, okay, in the future we need these capabilities about software, coding, agile development, and a few other things. And we have now started for all the middle management and the managers with classes, online courses, but also the ability to enhance your capabilities in studies, if you are more of a blue-collar worker, to actually start a systematic training of our employees. And as these systematic skill databases are not always common in Germany, we have decided to pilot that, and if the pilot is very successful, which I think it will be, we will discuss with our workers' council and our social partners actually how to spread it up, because I think we need to do something very systematic about skill building. And last comment talks to myself and yourself as a leaders and our CEOs. See, for leaders of companies, it's also what's true for everyone else, which is that the success patterns of the past are not necessarily success patterns of the future. I recently read in a magazine a sentence saying the CEO of company X, my dad, went to Palo Alto and afterwards he came back and commanded an empower to perform culture. Commanded an empower to perform culture. Okay. So I think the culture for us as leader has a lot to do with giving up on command and control, giving up on hierarchies, yeah, enforcing cross-function collaboration and also enforcing diversity. And I'm not only talking about gender diversity. It's age diversity, gender diversity, international diversity, subject diversity, any type of diversity. Yeah? And maybe last comment on that one. As mother, I always say, you know, the grass doesn't grow faster when you pull. Yeah? But you can actually totally destroy it by stamping on it and not giving water to it. And I think the role of the leaders, whether it's political leaders, managers, it needs to be to enable, to make things happen. Because the digitalization will be driven, if we get it right, a lot of by the entrepreneurial spirit, which we have, hopefully, in the companies. So this is how we need to change. And now coming to my last slide about what we generally need to do. I was already talking about education, and I will not repeat that one. I think we need to have really STEM and digital education for pupils and students. And as I'm seeing here, the group of female leaders, this is, by the way, we believe we need to do it for boys and for girls. Yeah? But when we look at the digital divide, specifically in STEM between boys and girls, again, we said specifically also for girls. Yeah, because the passion for computational science needs even more enhancement there, but we need it for all the kids. Number two, on infrastructure, if you are standing here as the Telekom Vorstand, I will normally get the remark, please, Mrs. Nehmert, before you talk about technology, do VDSL in our village. So therefore, please let me be clear, we are committed to doing so. We are very proud that we have in all the last years won the network test for the best mobile network. By the way, for me, that's not the thing. It's not enough. Whenever I discover a hole or have a voice drop, I'm in a paranoid manner hunting my team and saying, fix this. Yeah, we are committed to have a great network. The second thing, before we even run into 5G, and we are preparing the rollout, we are, of course, and yeah, Mr. Machnik knows that, and are heavily working, we, our industry partners and also others, in bringing broadband speed to Germany. NTT alone has actually committed to make sure that we have 80% covered by end of 2018, which is a huge investment, more than anyone else combined, but our CEO could explain it to our financial shareholders that we are going to do it, yeah? So we are really committed in building up at high speed. And by the way, the only limitation we are currently having is actually available construction capacity, yeah? You wouldn't think so. It's available construction capacity. And I get all these emails when people are saying, Mrs. Nehmert, why is it only in 2 months? And say, oh, we are coordinating all the construction. Yeah, but we are really committed. We are committed, and we will do so to build up these 80% for Germany broadband in this country. I should make one final remark on that one. I think regulation and politics should actually be really technological agnostic, because sometimes we try to outsmart in regulation technology. But technology developments are so fast, and even today you don't know how fast a certain speed on a certain technology will be in 2 years from now. We have already today the situation that our super vectoring technology is faster than most of the fiber to the home technologies in other European countries. Yeah? And so therefore, I would always have the wish for political leaders to make reliable regulatory frame conditions and define the outcome, coverage, speed, latency, etc., but leave it up to the industries to figure actually out how, I mean, from a technological perspective, we are going to do that, yeah? So that would be my plea here. And otherwise, I would just say, let's get to the spirit I was describing at the beginning. The digitization, the so-called digitization, so the need to connect everything and everyone and apply artificial intelligence on top of that, will be the more successful, the more we are there. The more we drive it, the more we are passionate and not afraid of. Yeah? And let me finish with one big role model of my childhood, who was Marie Curie. And she said, guys, there's nothing to be afraid of, only to be understood. And I think that should be the spirit in which we drive it. So thank you very much.
You can come, I'll come. Thank you. Thank you very much to Claudia Nemat for sharing with us your vision for the future, your call for change, a lot to incorporate in our panel sessions that are coming up after coffee. Coffee, a very important time of the day, but before you all head out, we have some important logistical notes for you. This room is going to look very different when you come back here. We're going to have three separate panels, so what we're doing is we're dividing this room. If you're interested in panel number one, it will be right here. If you're interested in panel number two, it will be directly behind you. And if you're interested in panel number three, it's going to be outside and to your left. That room is called the Cashmere Room. I mentioned, it's very luxurious. I hear a couple people giggling there. I mentioned earlier that I host the main news program at Deutsche Welle TV in Berlin. Well, a number of my colleagues are also here with me today, and they are going to be moderating your panel session. So I leave you now in good hands. A quick reminder, we have to get out of here very quickly, and we all have to be back at 12:15. We want to be punctual. We'll see you soon.